for joining us this week for another edition of the Brody File. We have got so much jam-packed into this show, it makes that health care bill on the Hill look like a little children's book. Check out who decided to stop by this week.
The media attention is can be flattering if you let it.
The new GOP rock star Marco Rubio talks about his newfound stardom and defends himself against accusations flying his way. Plus, Glenn Beck wants Christians to leave social justice churches. He gets an earful from Jim Wallace in our Faith and Politics segment.
Christians should leave Glenn Beck.
Also, show me some Tea Party love. Yeah, a look at the politicians they love and the politicos who they want to run out of town. But first, a year ago, nobody knew the name Marco Rubio. Now, if you follow politics, he is a household name. The Republican from Florida is taking on the popular, nicely tanned by the way, Republican heavyweight Charlie Crist for the U.S. Senate. Once trailing badly, Rubio now is up by double digits, but Crist is not going down without a fight, saying Rubio is not all he's cracked up to be. I spoke with Rubio a few weeks ago in this Brody File show exclusive. Let me get right to it. Here's a biblical analogy for you. You've been David, and here's Crist as Goliath to a degree, and here you are up in the polls. I know you don't want to talk about polls and all of that. You're focused on the job at hand, but I mean, how did this meteoric rise, because that's what the media is calling it, how did it happen specifically?
Yeah. Well, first of all, remember David won. So right. I always remind people of that.
Right.
You know what it is? Early on in this campaign, people didn't know they had a choice. There was a name on the ballot they recognized. They didn't know anything about me. And then we gave them a choice. In essence, this campaign is built on some very simple concepts, that America is the greatest nation in all of human history, that everything that's made America great, they're now trying to change in Washington, D.C., that we need to send people to Washington, D.C. that will stand up to this agenda and that will offer a clear alternative, and that we're the only candidate in this race that's going to do that. That's been the simple, central message of this campaign on the day it started, and that's what it's going to be until the day it ends.
You know, I wonder, though, if there also isn't some of this moderate poster boy for Charlie Crist. I mean, he's been the kind of the moderate Republican guy, and here you come along at this conflux of the Tea Party movement as well and the Obama administration. If it's not somewhat of a perfect storm here as well.
Well, whether it's Arlen Specter or Charlie Crist, there's always been some in the Republican Party that believe that the way Republicans become more successful is by behaving like Democrats. I never bought into that. I mean, I always felt this nation already had a Democrat Party. It didn't need two Democrat parties.
You've made some headway on the stimulus, you know, Crist and Obama, and you got the website going on. You got the visuals of them together on the stimulus. But then there's been some talk about how, at least the headlines have been, that you may be backtracking a little bit on the stimulus yourself. And I want you to clear that up a little bit, because you had said that ultimately, look, if you were in that position, you may have to indeed accept those funds too. Can you clear that up
a little
bit?
There's some important things to remember about the stimulus. Number one, when the stimulus was offered last February, there were a lot of people here in Washington, D.C. that were working to offer an alternative to it. They knew it wasn't going to work. Okay, and a lot of Republicans that were working to offer real alternatives to this. When Charlie Crist stood on that stage and became one of the only Republicans, prominent Republicans in the country, to campaign for the stimulus, not just to endorse it, but to campaign for the stimulus, he cut the legs out from underneath all of those people that were working so hard to offer an alternative. Now, from the perspective of this race, what matters is very simple. I'm running for the U.S. Senate. If I had been a United States Senator when the stimulus package was offered, I would have voted against the stimulus, and I would have been a hardworking, outspoken, critic of it and offered an alternative to it. That's what I would have done. Had Charlie Crist been in the U.S. Senate, he would have voted for the stimulus package. He would have been one of only three Republicans, and Arlen Specter, to vote for it.
Let me ask you real quick about this political maneuver by the Crist campaign 24 hours before you're going to come speak at CPAC. They put out this prepared, not for delivery, not prepared remarks. I mean, you've seen it, obviously. What did you think of that tactic? What did you think of the content inside of that? Because they're, in essence, saying, hey, when you get to know Marco Rubio, it's a different picture. And I'm curious as to what you thought of the tactic.
Well, I mean, I think they're desperate. Certainly, because they know that this election is about sending an alternative to Washington. They know that this election is about people wanting to send someone to Washington that will stand up to the Obama agenda and offer a clear alternative, and no one views Charlie Crist as that. So he knows that if the election is about that, he's going to lose. He's going to have to try to make it about something else. they're a desperate campaign. I think he's willing to say or do anything to get elected, and he's got the money to say a lot of these things. And sadly, he's not willing to tell the truth about his own record, so we can't expect him to tell the truth about mine.
Do you ever get concerned that you may, because you're human and we're all human, we get sucked into the power and influence of Washington, D.C., and look, some special interest money does come in because the Republican Party kind of operates in that environment. How concerned are you about being kind of caught up in that?
The day you're not concerned about losing yourself in this process is the day you're in danger of losing yourself in this process. I think we all need to realize that we're human, that we're flawed, and that we are vulnerable. Just like we're vulnerable in our personal lives, we are vulnerable in our political lives. And so it's important for folks who get elected to office to recognize that they are walking into a very powerful political culture that over time changes even the best of us.
Let me ask you a little bit about faith and how much that is important, how much that drives you, and also, you know, this idea about not excluding God from the public domain, if you will, but incorporating God into
I think that any reasonable and accurate reading of the founding of the American Republic, you quickly realize that our nation was built on spiritual concepts just as strongly as it was on political concepts. The notion that our rights, our dignity, our value as human beings finds its genesis in our Creator, not in our government or in our leaders, is extremely powerful. I mean, it's the very essence of what made was founded our country.
The media spotlight. What is it like to be in the media spotlight? More importantly, what does your wife think of you being in the media spotlight?
You know, my wife is she does a great job of reminding me that it's not about me, that it is about what we stand for, and that all we are vehicles. We're vessels that get blessed from time to time to do things, including in this campaign, be a voice for a set of principles that a growing number of Americans want to see represented in the political process. The media attention can be flattering if you let it. I think if you just stop and think, you realize there's been a lot of other people that have been where I am right now, and it hasn't turned out well for them, you know, personally or politically. I think the important thing for us is just to keep focused on what matters. And what matters is not the articles and the stories and all that kind of thing. What matters is what do we stand for? 40, 50 years from now, when I talk to my kids and grandkids about this campaign, irrespective of how it turns out, and I think we're going to win, but irrespective of how it turns out, will I be proud of what we did, or will I look back and be ashamed of it?
Thanks, Marco. Marco Rubio here on the Brody File. You know, here at the Brody File, we are everywhere. We're not only hanging with Marco Rubio, we also showed up at the Radio Television Correspondents Association dinner. That's a mouthful. It's kind of like the prom, where there's media, there's Hollywood, there's political stars. They're all hanging out, you know, puffy hair, heels, rented tuxedos, all that. I wasn't in heels, by the way. But Brody File producer Dana Ritter was, and she took along a video camera. So we now present to you the first edition of a feature we're going to call Dana Cam.
Hey, y'all, this is Dana Ritter with the Brody File. We're on the road on the way to the Radio Television Correspondents Dinner. It's my first time. Freshman year.
Have you ever come before?
Wait, I hope you're
going to
talk
this celebrity sighting. We got it. Celebrity sighting number one.
Who am I saying hi to?
To the Brody File.
Yeah,
hi, David.
Marsha, how are you?
Michelle Bachman totally just got us in here. Party crashing. Here we go.
You know, I was there at Congress yesterday. We are not so vocal today. What do you think? Do you still stand?
She's really passionate.
Senator Joe Lieberman.
Hi, Senator.
How are you?
I'm seeing politician galore. You know, it's kind of like Hollywood for nerds, right?
Former Virginia governor and Senator George Allen over there. My friend Kim Schwan.
Hey, girl!
Senator Schwan up here talking about Brody Wilson.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah,
up next, Glenn Beck wants Christians to leave social justice churches, but a religious leader says Christians should leave Glenn Beck.
No, 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 no!
And later, the Dems may have their health care bill, but beware of the angry mob on the Hill and at the ballot box. Back in a moment.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart.
These are the most powerful songs of our time.
Now is the time to worship.
And now, for the first time, the biggest praise and worship songs are together.
How great is our God.
Presenting Songs for Worship 50. 50 songs in one specially priced collection.
Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The earth is filled.
You'll hear 50 beautiful songs of hope.
I'm coming back to the heart of worship. And it's
50 powerful songs of faith. Get Songs for Worship 50 on three CDs for only $24.99.
Here I am to worship. Here I am.
But wait, order in the next 10 minutes with your credit card, and we'll take $15 off. That's right. You get 50 praise and worship songs for just
$9.99.
Then preview other great praise and worship collections. Satisfaction guaranteed.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
So call now and get Songs for Worship 50. 50 beautiful songs on three CDs for just
$9.99. Call 1-800-435-3414 to order Songs for Worship 50 on three CDs for $9.99 plus shipping and handling when you use your credit card. Call now or order online at timelife.com/songsforworship50.
In our Faith and Politics segment tonight, we have, I have to tell you, a guest that we've been wanting to get for quite a while, Jim Wallace, the founder, president of Sojourners here in Washington and really across the country. Jim, thanks so
great
much for joining.
Great to see you, David, as always.
Hey, I've got to ask you, let's start with your book, because this Rediscovering Values, and here's the money line here, it's literally the money line, our on Wall Street, Main Street, and your street, because you are saying in this book that we have a major moral issue here on Wall Street. Explain exactly what's going on.
Underneath the economic crisis, there's a values crisis. So we won't get to economic recovery without a moral recovery to accompany and shape that as well. So we shouldn't just ask, when will the crisis end? We should ask, how will the crisis change us? We have the bad morality play of banks and bailouts and bonuses. That's bad enough. But underneath that, there's an erosion of societal values, like these new maxims, David. Mm-hmm. Greed is good. It's all about me, and I want it now. Counter to that, I say in the book, what about some old virtues like enough is enough? We're in this together. And I love the Native American ethic. You evaluate decisions today by their impact on the seventh generation out. It's called stewardship in the Bible. So I think our biblical values here really could correct some of these things that have gone so terribly wrong.
All right, well, let's delve into a few other topics here, hodgepodge a little bit. Glenn Beck, he has basically said he wants Christians to leave churches that are preaching social justice. That must have gotten under your skin. Tell me a little bit about your reaction to that.
Well, Glenn Beck has told Christians whose churches care about, preach, practice social justice to leave their churches. This is a central tenet of the teaching of Jesus. Throughout scriptures, God's biblical imperatives. So I'm saying Christians should leave Glenn Beck. They should stop watching his show. Howard Stern's practices pornography on his show. Glenn Beck is denying central cores to our faith. And so I'm saying Christians, it's time to pray for Howard Stern, pray for Glenn Beck, but don't watch Glenn Beck's show anymore. And we should turn in all the priests and clergy who are talking about social justice, starting with Pope Benedict and maybe Mother Teresa and the National Association of Evangelicals, evangelical churches, Pentecostal churches, Catholic churches, black churches, Hispanic, Asian American, mainline Protestant, we all understand the biblical imperatives for social justice, part of God's plan. Glenn Beck is saying, leave churches who practice Christian faith. And so we need to stop watching The Glenn Beck Show. Mm.
The Faith Council, real quick. What is the takeaway from all of this? We had Joel Hunter on in one of our previous shows. I'm curious as to how you see this going forward. Look, these are recommendations. There are a lot of them. There are a lot of parts to each one of them. I mean, is this going to collect dust on a shelf? I mean, this is Washington. It's bureaucratic. You know, it could end up being bureaucratic gobbledygook. I mean, clearly you guys did some important work, but what if the people aren't paying attention too much?
Well, your skepticism about Washington is always well-founded. So we both live in this town.
Right.
The recommendations, first of all, the group was extraordinary. It was really, I enjoyed being with this powerful group of faith leaders, interfaith, very diverse, mm-hmm. and some secular as well. But we had a good time together. It was a real, we reached common ground on almost everything. There's a real sense of respect for each other and learn from each other. These recommendations, it's a big report.
Yeah.
Your folks aren't going to all read it all. But there's some very powerful recommendations here. And if they were implemented, they would change big things and really improve the partnership between government and faith-based organizations, really improve it, take it to a whole different level. And yesterday, we had top administration officials tell us, one said, this is going to be a work plan for my cabinet department. Others said, I've already read these. We're working on these. So the promises were strong.
Mm-hmm.
But you're right. Time will tell. But the faith-based office has promised to monitor, in fact, the implementation of these recommendations. And some of us said, we're not leaving either. I mean, we're leaving the council. But our relationship with this administration in terms of accountability continues. Faith leaders should hold politicians accountable for the very reason you talked about. Washington is wired to block change, always has been. So that means movements, usually social movements of faith, have to put their feet to the fire and hold them accountable. We got good promises yesterday from this administration, and I want to take them at face value, and then we'll hold people accountable.
Jim Wallace, thank you so much
Great
for joining us.
You.
I appreciate it. The book, Rediscovering Values on Wall Street, Main Street, and Your Street. Again, thanks, Jim.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. When we come back, some are calling him Dennis the Menace. We call him the Oy Vey moment of the week. And Mitt Romney, uncut and uncensored. Don't worry, it's tame. Back in a moment.
Each week, thousands of concerned parents and grandparents start Globe Young American plans for their children and grandchildren. The Young American Plan is a simple, affordable way to secure valuable life insurance protection. Starting a Young American Plan today guarantees the future insurability of your loved ones. Once issued, the Young American Plan can never be canceled. For just $1, you can start a Young American Plan and feel safe knowing you've provided your child or grandchild with a lifetime of protection. The regular premium you establish now is guaranteed to never increase. And the Young American Plan builds cash value that can be used in the future. Since 1964, millions of concerned parents and grandparents have started Globe Young American Plans for their children and grandchildren. Call Globe today.
Call right now for complete information about the Globe Young American Plan. Call Globe today at 1-800-457-4154.
And welcome back to the Brody File, where the green room always filled with bagels and lox. Have you ever wondered what politicians the Tea Party just loves the most? Well, on an unrelated issue, by the way, have you ever wondered why you're watching this show and asking yourself when it'll be over? Anyhow, I digress. Back to the Tea Party. Politico decided to survey more than 36 Tea Party leaders from 29 states, and they asked them who they love the most. So, who is feeling the love? Q, Elton John.
And can you feel the love tonight? Is where we are.
I love that song. All right, sorry, sue me, whatever. All right, in order of Love Fest, here we go. Jim DeMint comes in at number one, followed closely by Michelle Bachmann and then Sarah Palin. Now, what about the ones they are most disappointed with? Well, John McCain tops the list, of course. Then you've got his 2008 traveling buddy, Senator Lindsey Graham. He's there.
And then, of course, you have the moderate Senate sisters. Not the Pointer sisters. No, no. These are the moderate Senate sisters. All right, they're not sisters. But anyhow, Susan Collins and Olympia Snow. You know, this is a very emotional segment here on The Brody File. We've gone from love to disappointment and now to outright anger. Our Brody File cameras were on the Hill to capture the madness this past weekend when Nancy Pelosi and company passed that 2,700-page health care bill. Tea Party folks were going berserk about this whole thing, but you know what? It's not going to matter much unless they take that palpable anger and express it at the ballot box. Then maybe Pelosi, the White House, and others will get the message. So now that health care reform has become law, it has given us a plethora of choices when it comes to choosing this week's winner for Oy Vey Moment of the Week. This week's winner, Congressman Dennis Kucinich of Ohio, a staunch liberal opponent of Obama's health care reform plan for 14 solid months. And then he did the classic flip-flop, Oy Vey, or as we call it here at the Brody File, the Kucinich switch, from no to yes. Listen to him at his switcheroo press conference.
I would not support the bill unless it had a strong public option. I've continued to oppose it. I have doubts about the bill. I do not think it is a step toward anything I've supported in the past. This is not the bill I wanted to support.
So he doesn't like the bill, right? Right, Dennis?
I've decided to cast a vote in favor of the legislation.
That is not only an Oy Vey moment, that is taking it to the Oy Gavolt level. All right, with that Oy Vey moment, it's time for this week's Brody File commentary. In the midst of all the Democratic backslapping after health care reform passed this week, there was a potential downside for Democrats. President Obama has said that the health care bill will end up being the smart thing to do politically because he believes good policy is good politics. But look, here's the deal. If good policy is good politics, what is bad policy? Bad politics? Since the majority of Americans think this specific health care reform plan is bad policy, the politics for the Democrats could end up being very bad for them in November. A majority of Americans agree that health care reform is needed, but this huge bill wasn't necessarily what they had in mind. Back in a moment.
Introducing Easy Combs, the easy new way to create dazzling new do's. Simply slide in one end, stretch it around your hair, and slide in on the other side for an updo that's brand new. Or fluff it out for a fountain effect. Look again. The bungee band stretch and release for a relaxed custom fit every time. Liven up a ponytail or create this amazing butterfly twist. It's great for short hair and ideal for the office. It's perfect for any formal occasion. Ouch, claw clips hurt. But Easy Combs are soft and comfortable, so easy to use, kids love them too. Now get Easy Combs in caramel bronze for only $10. Call now and get one in dazzling silver. As a special bonus, get our Bermuda Black plus a styling DVD. Just pay separate shipping and handling. With the step-by-step DVD, Easy Combs are a cinch. You get caramel, silver, and black plus the style guide and DVD, a $60 value, all for only $10.
Call 1-800-520-1486. You'll get the bonus Easy Combs as advertised when you call 1-800-520-1486.
Love to shop for shoes, but there's no place to store them? You're always running out of room to store more. Introducing Shoes Under, the easy solution to organize and protect your shoes. The clear zipper cover locks out dust and moisture. Now you just slide and store. It's that easy. With two handles, you can easily store your shoes here, under there, almost everywhere, and turn an empty space into a super storage place. Other shoe organizers can cost a fortune, but through this exclusive television offer, you can get the 12-compartment Shoes Under for only $19.99. Call now and we'll cut that price in half. That's right, for only $10. And as a bonus, we'll double the offer and give you a second Shoes Under that's enough space for 48 shoes. Just pay separate shipping and handling. Call now and get two Shoes Under for only $10.
call 1-800-943-1652. You'll get a second one free, so call 1-800-943-1652. That's 1-800-943-1652. Call now.
And welcome back to the Brody File. This week on the cutting room floor, we go inside Mitt Romney's private jet. True, this interview was done during 2008 when he was running for president. We were invited on his plane. It was just a quick couple minutes. Have a look.
What's the best part about campaign travel and the worst part about campaign travel?
The best part is just getting to meet remarkable people. You're lucky to see the kinds of friends that I've now made across the country. That's the best part of it. Oh, and by the way, I get to see my grandkids pretty often. I'm in California from time to time, and so I see them more frequently than otherwise. And the worst part, of course, is just different room every night, different bed every night.
Yeah.
And, you know, you sort of get used to your own pillow and your own bed. And I think in the month of March, I had 27 or 28 straight days in a hotel room, different hotel, almost every night. Yeah, it gets tiring, but you get a lot of energy from the people you meet. You get more energy than you give because people are enthusiastic. Puts you higher and higher as you get a chance to meet with people.
Well, okay, tell me what you do on the phone. A lot of reading? What
mostly
do you
reading. I write some notes. I do some reading. Mm-hmm. That's about it. If I'm lucky, a little food.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
See you,
Dave.
It's good seeing you.
Look at that. Hobnobbing on Mitt Romney's plane. Impressive. We were shortly arrested after that, but that's a whole other matter. All right, finally. Just kidding. I'm just kidding. All right, finally tonight, because we're so hip, we're cool, we're fat, whatever, a new quick segment we like to call Tweet of the Week, or maybe Tweets of the Week. How about this tweet from Tim Pawlenty? T-Paw comes in and writes, quote, Mary and I are looking forward to meeting with conservative bloggers this evening for happy hour. Rick Warren is tweeting. He says, quote, if you spend more time defending the truth than actually sharing it, you'll miss the point of the gospel. How true. And then how about Brody File fan Ashton Kutcher? All right, that was an embellishment. He's not a fan. But the popular tweeter tweets, just met Lady Gaga, thoroughly impressed. I can assure you that Lady Gaga will not be a Brody File newsmaker of the week. That does it for this week's edition of the Brody File. We're taking a few weeks off. I head to vacation to Italy. Maybe we're going to start an Italian version of the Brody File. You never know. I may tweet from Florence. Until then, arrivederci. God bless and good night.
You're watching CBN News Channel. Available on the web 24/7 at cbnnewschannel.com.